incredibly fierce, close racing all the way at the front of the fleet as the question of who will lead into Newport is pushing our sailors' concentration to the limit. Welcome to the Ocean Race Show, where we are on day 9 of leg 4. 2,500 nautical miles completed, and the same still to go in that push up to Newport. We're in race headquarters, where all the drama out on the racetrack is monitored right in this room. And our four remaining boats out on the water have put on quite the show. The fleet have split. First, Guyot Environment Team Europe slipped behind, leaving 100 miles in a few hours due to repairing the foil system. Then, Bioterm struggling to hold the pace of the other two, and they have fallen back 50 miles. Not as large, but it does risk the French boat falling off the wind that the leaders are enjoying. 11th Hour Racing Team and Team Malizia are still neck and neck as the boats were able to sail along the rum line straight to the finish. All our boats using their AIS technology as a constant feedback to the crews at just how close the racing is.
We got the AIS speed and distance and headings here. 1, 2, 5, 10 minutes. And over 10 minutes, we're same speed. In fact, they've actually gone just a little faster over the last minute. It's very much dependent on the pressure as it comes in and out.
While the stress levels were high on board, there is still the fact that doing huge speeds in high-tech foilers is a great way to spend your day as a sailor.
Doing the odd 29, and averaging 24. But only in 18 knots of breeze, so that's pretty good.
You enjoying being back on the race course?
It is, actually, I have to say, don't tell anyone.
Damien Foxall on board 11th Hour Racing Team, enjoying some speed. But the big moment for all of our boats was entering the doldrums. And the worry for the sailors was that the wind would become very unstable.
So we just entered the doldrum this morning with a big cloud that is fog. We are here, so you can see all the clouds there in the doldrums.
The doldrums always makes our sailors uneasy, as they know that bad luck can cost them huge distances. But first, there is the simple problem of it getting too hot to work.
How are you feeling, Chris?
A bit hot. It's so hot in the bank this morning.
Really?
For the first time in 8 days, no socks. And really, it's hot in the back. And this is a nice place of all the boats, because there is a kind of air circulation without Marseillais exaggeration, like 10 degrees less than in the back. So it's nice.
Too hot to get a good sleep, despite the big breeze outside. And while it might be unpleasant when on watch, there are plenty of reminders to keep your concentration up. For Team Malizia, we can see how quickly the boat overpowers and starts to dangerously heel. Will was quickly into action, easing the correct sheet and steering the boat through the autopilot. They might be high-tech, but the boats do not sail themselves. Moments like these are far more common in the doldrums, or at least in the lead up and out of them, where powerful rain systems build up pressure and create huge differences in temperature and airflow as the wind is squeezing through gaps and also turbocharged by the rain. It all creates squalls and areas where the wind will just jump out of nowhere, ready to upset the balance of the boat.
Ah oui, là, il faut faire quelque chose. Une deux, c'est bien. Ouais.
The clouds might cause headaches tactically, but the ones that come with rain also allow the crews to wash, something that they can rarely spare water for. While the fleet are fighting squalls and showering in the rain, Team Holcim-PRB have been able to tick off the first stage of their plan to rejoin the race. They have secured space on the deck of a cargo ship heading north to Newport, Rhode Island.
So we are hanging on this vessel, cargo vessel. We are on our, this is actually a really important moment because the boat will go on this cargo ship. Meaning that if it's all going according plan, boat will go up in now and 2 hours. Fixed boat lease. On time in Newport. On time to get the new mast ready and in time for leg five.
There will be lots to do while the boat is on its journey, not least preparing the new mast when it arrives in Newport. If all goes to plan, the rig will be waiting for the hull and the two will be joined together before the next leg. But the timing is tight. Fingers crossed, all the pieces of their plan come together smoothly. Team Holcim-PRB are focused on the points for the next leg. But for Guyu Environment Team Europe, they are still racing in leg four, but with a slim chance of improving their position. For the sailors, it would be easy to feel defeated at this point. The boat is over 200 miles behind, all because of the foiling line breaking and forcing them to come off the throttle. This allowed the other boats to sail away with the breeze, but Annie Lush seems to be making sure that everyone stays confident about what they can do in the later stages of this leg.
They were doing 25 knots, yeah. So it's not that we lost like 4 hours. They were doing 25 knots away from us,
yeah.
And then we couldn't do 25 knots.
Yeah, but just behind there is no wind, so yeah. No wind is coming to us. They can left with gusty wind.
We know we have to stay with that wind, and yeah. When we weren't with it anymore, it's gone. In English, it's an expression that if something bad happens in it or difficult happens in it, but there's a silver lining, and the silver lining is like the good thing.
And when the wind did find its way back to the boat, the team were ready. In the darkness, they set the sails, strapped down the old ones, and started chasing any opportunities to close the miles to the leaders.
You are in the deep freeze, so I come in.
Another significant moment for our boats as they exit the southern hemisphere, crossing the equator and heading back north to home.
What about the equator?
Yes, and hopefully we're going to cross in first by about 200 meters, I'd say. It's going to be a dogfight the whole way up, I think. We're in the northern hemisphere.
Yeah, I feel a bit more home now. You know, I can just... It's just a different smell, the northern hemisphere. It's just a different vibe.
A moment's recognition for crossing the equator, and while Team Militia did cross it first, there was so little separating them from the American team that they had to get straight back to work. And what do you do when the racing is this close? How do you squeeze every last drop of speed out of your boat, especially when it's conditions that change with every rain cloud? On board Team Militia, they've split the job roles. Will Harris, the temporary skipper on this leg, is managing the sails and trimming for maximum power.
Stable, building a bit in one leg.
Chris is at the back, looking out of the cockpit and calling in the breeze and the ever-changing conditions, alerting the crew when the wind's going to increase and how long they have to prepare for it. And Roslyn Kuiper is on the helm. She's remote steering through the autopilot system, as well as adjusting the keel. This is the control panel that Rosie's using, and a lot of you have been asking as to exactly what all these buttons do. How do you control the helm with one finger and the keel with the other? Well, once again, let's hear from an expert.
All right, so you probably see us touching all this quite often. So this is the pilot that controls the autopilot. This one down is controlling the keel. So this will move the keel to starboard. This will move the keel to port. This will stop the keel in any moment if you're happy with how much keel we have. And this blue button is basically floating the keel back, center it. And that's it.
So with one hand on the autopilot system and with the other on the keel, Rosie is balancing the boat, both in its heading and in its heel. And all the time, she's making calculations based on the information that's being fed to her by the computer readouts. This is human concentration at its absolute limit. This is a big difference in terms of sailing from what we've seen with the VO65s in the past. This is no longer helming by feel. All of us have grown up sailors are used to holding a tiller or holding a wheel and instinctively knowing what to do. But being able to look at that computer readout using all the different data that's being fed into from all the sensors around the boat and then knowing whether you want to tell the boat to bear away 1, 5, 10 degrees or maybe come up as well and what to do with the keel, that takes an awful lot of maths inside your head. Maybe Rosie and the rest of the sailors out there on the fleet have got to the point where they can do that without thinking. But either way, it's pretty impressive. And there was the same level of intensity on board for 11th Hour Racing Team, with Damien Foxall standing at the back of the boat and calling in the big squalls.
All right, here it comes.
Charlie Enright, sitting in the bubble, was coordinating the work of the crew to turn the extra power coming into speed.
Yeah, bigger one still 3-4 out.
They have a big header and they're doing 32 knots now. Okay, 60 wind here, lots of weather.
Never done with the Doldrums.
And just when the team left the squall behind, another swept over from the side and threatened to catch them off guard.
Pretty frustrating, but there's always plenty of action as well. Big squalls and big change of wind direction and pressure. So living that dream right now. 23 knots, 24 knots, and big shit.
It's been close with Militia now for seems like days, and we've been fighting for every inch, and they're hard to get.
Both teams had to keep up the high work rate for hours as each small drop in concentration was instantly turned into distance lost. Distance that you could see and measure in meters while the boats remained this close. The intensity continued into the night, and as the wind dropped, the remote helming system was turned off and traditional hand steering set up. On Team Militia, their tiller can be mounted outside on top of the coach roof, giving the helm a good view of the sails and the conditions to come. But even with such a nice setup, 11th Hour Racing Team, who traded to the windward position at sunset, rolled over the top of the Germans and began to sail away. From there, the American boats stretched away and have built up a lead of over 20 miles, just enough to potentially ride out some of the tricky conditions to come. In 24 hours, the leaders of this leg are going to see the wind direction reverse. And that's going to be a crucial moment to get right, both in terms of where you are on the racetrack, but also what you do with a boat when that moment hits. And for Guyu Environment Team Europe, it might provide an opportunity to attack if they can find the right conditions to close up. It would be a big ask, but considering how quickly they lost the miles in the first place, perhaps they could wing them back just as fast. For Kevin Escoffier and Team Holcim-PRB, they are on their way to Newport, and fingers crossed, they're going to have that boat race ready before the start of the next leg. The big question is, which of our teams are going to do the most damage to the Swiss boat's lead, claiming the top 5 points available for winning this leg? We're going to have to wait and see.